So today my talk is about CD8 T cells and fatty acid ulcers, tumor, ferroptosis, and immunity through the ACSL4. So once we we know the life. So we know the lifespan of the human being improved in the modern society, and the cancer is a more common disease to affect the quality of life. So when we go back to review, so how the researchers and doctors to cure the tumor and prevent tumor genesis. So they have different strategy. So early on, so people doctors have the surgery to take off the tumor. So later, people also find out that radiotherapy can really cure the tumors. And after the 1940, so to have the chemotherapy, and recently, and so it's very famous by the target therapy use small chemical. And after in the new centuries, so the immune checkpoint, the immune checking blockade, so give that new strategy, and also looks is also very powerful. So when we So that's why we're asking, so how does T cell to kill the tumor cells, typical cytotoxic CD8 T cells to kill the T cells. So once the CD8 cells are primed by the epithelial antigen presenting cells, so the CD8 T cell will use a different strategy to kill the tumor cells following the tumor cells. So either as a Marina took at the first talk. So CD8 T cells will release the porphyrin and the granzyme B. So then the, and also the CD8 T cells also can release the other cytokines such as interferon gamma and TNF alpha. So, and to induce the tumor cell senescence. And also, the CD8 can directly interact with the tumor cells or use the fast ligand to trigger the apoptosis. And recently, so our group found out that use the interferon gamma plus the fibrosis inducer, ACSL3, so also can trigger tumor cell fibrosis. So, and also, I think last year, another group demonstrated the granzyme A, which released by cytotoxic T cells can trigger tumor cells use the cleaver the gas team B. So CD cells will use a different strategy and to kill tumor cells by the apoptosis or fibrosis and the apoptosis. So we are interested in about the fibrosis. So because early on our group found out when we use the IDA, the tumor ovarian cancer tumor model as the model. So when we gave the anti-PD-1 to treat the tumor mice, so this result is very expected. So the tumor by just treatment is much smaller than the control group. And the very interesting thing is, so once we take out the tumor samples and then getting by the CD8 45 of the negative cells, we consider is tumor cells. Then we analyze the lipid rows. So one of the character of the fibrosis. So as you can see in the anti-PD-1 treatment group, the tumor cells have very dramatic increase of the lipid rows. And most interesting, so in the immunotherapy model, so you can see here, and once the tumor burning mice receive the CD-alpha and PD-L1 therapy, the tumor is much repressed. But even once we give the liposomal, so it's a fibrosis inhibitor, and the anti-tumor effect is almost abolished by these inhibitors. So here, we find out the fibrosis is present during the immunotherapy. And so before we introduce to share the story, so the new study, and we would like to talk about what is the fibrosis. So it is an a non-apoptotic ion-dependent form of cell death, which can be activated by the cancer cells or either by natural stimulation or synthetic agents. So first, this type of cell death will trigger by this redox-activated ion. So in the cell will cause a lot of the ROS, the lipid, the reductive oxygen species. And then this ROS will cause the phospholipid, typically the polyunsaturated fatty acid, will have the accumulation of the lipid peroxidation on the membrane. So if the cell itself lost the deactivated or inhibited the lipid peroxidation repair, so use the glucagon or the CoQ system. So finally, the cell will have the ferroptosis process. So before I was mentioned, so during the immune checkpoint blockade, and we found out that the ferroptosis the immunotherapy can sensitize the tumor ferroptosis. So the combination of this synthetic ferroptosis inducer, such as the R3 plus PD-L1 will synergistically enhance the anti-tumor efficacy in the clinical model. But however, even gamma alone or R3, they can not directly initiate or induce the tumor cell the ferroptosis in the in vitro. So I mean, infrared gamma alone cannot induce the ferroptosis. So we're wondering whether or how tumor cell can undergo endogenous the ferroptosis in the absence of the synthetic chemical inducer. So it's still we all know. So based on the ferroptosis character, we know the fatty acid play a very important role during the ferroptosis process. So we have this very simple idea. So if we use a different fatty acid to, in the same time, co-treatment with the infrared gamma, whether some of the fatty acid will have the synergistic to induce the tumor cells. So as here, so as the red dot is the infrared gamma treatment, then we give different fatty acid treatment combined with infrared gamma, as you can see here. So very interesting, one of the fatty acid is called arginine acid, it's a polyunsaturated fatty acid, which can dramatically increase infrared gamma induce cell death of the other cells. So we treat a different type of tumor cells. So among the different cells, among different type of cells, tumor cells, so only the arginine acid can give our very consistent result, which is the infrared gamma plus A can induce tumor cells. So all of this tumor cell is caused by the 5% FBS, because during the experiment, we found out that, so usually, as we know, usually in the in vitro culture, we prefer use the 10% FBS, but quite interesting. So for the fatty acid study, we found out that the lower serving of the FBS that the cell is more sensitive for those fatty acid treatment. So that's why in the entire project, we always use 5% of FBS to culture tumor cells. Then we're wondering, so which type of this combination treatment that induces cell death? And so then we give different cell death inhibitor, include apoptosis and necrotosis and apoptosis. So quite interesting, only ferroptosis inhibitor can block infrared gamma and A induced cell death. And as we know also, the lipid rose is one of the character of ferroptosis. It's also, as you can see here, is very expected. So only ferroptosis inhibitor can block infrared gamma A induced the lipid rose, other than the other cell death inhibitors. So then we are wondering, so what is the mechanism by infrared gamma plus arginine acid induced the tumor cell fibrosis? So early on, people then identified the ACSL4, so which is the acid CoA synthesized long chain family member. So the main function is active the arginine acid to have the arachidonic CoA, which is acid into the phospholipids. So here, so that means ACSL4 can use the free fatty acid, typical it's arginine acid, to synthesize the AA-CoA. Then this AA-CoA can integrate into the phospholipid to generate the polyunsaturated fatty acid associated phospholipid. So based on this idea, so we generally generate these local cells in this young 5.2 cells, in these tumor cells. So it's very consistent with the pathology result. So when we use the ACSL4 inducer, so it's a ferroptosis inducer, which is, can dramatically reduce the white type cells cell viability. But in the knockout cells, as you can see here, so this knockout cell is totally resistant to this drug treatment. So then we give our, you know, put in our conditions. So clearly see the infrared gamma and A can dramatically induce the white type tumor cell death, but not in the ACSL4 knockout cells. So in this case, we are thinking infrared gamma and A still use the ACSL4 as the molecular mechanism to induce the tumor cell death. And also, it's rely on the lipid loss by infrared gamma and A treatment. So how infrared gamma to regulate ACSL4 expression? So basically we examined mRNA and the protein level. So interesting, the infrared gamma can increase the ACSL4 mRNA level. Also by recent blood, we found out the protein level also be increased by this infrared gamma treatment. So then we know the slide one is a classical, the key gene doing infrared gamma signal pathway. So once we look out this CD1 in this YAM5.2 cells, the ACL4 induction by infrared gamma is totally abolished. Also, in the CD1 knockout cells, we find out similar result. The infrared gamma plus A also cannot induce the tumor cell death. So which is mean the infrared gamma goes to CD1 pathway to induce the tumor cell death. So when we analyze the genomic signaling, and as here you can see, when we analyze ACSL4 promoter region, so we found out that they have very strong alpha-1. So one of the downstream STAT1 pathway, they have very strong peak on this ACSL4 promoter region. Also, we check this by the chip IC. So indeed, the alpha-1 can directly binding on this ACSL4 promoter region on just two of binding sites. Instead of CD1, so CD1 cannot bind on this ACSL4 promoter region. So once we know the infrared gamma can, once we know the ACSL4 is very critical during infrared gamma and A induce the tumor cell death. So we are wondering, because the cellular lipid composition and the fatty acid metabolism is controlled ferroptosis. So apart from the ACSL4 expression, we are wondering whether infrared gamma combined with arginine acid can affect the tumor cell lipids or not. So we labeled the arginine acid. So this is arginine structure. So we labeled this by this hydrogen. So when we perform the experiment, so in this control group, and this is by the target lipid atomic data analysis. So once we combine infrared gamma and labeled A treatment, so we find out the tumor cell, the associated the phospholipids dramatically changed in some specific lipids. So when next we quantify different type of the phospholipid, so it's quite interesting. So the infrared gamma plus arginine acid can specifically increase in some type of the phospholipid, typical in just phosphoinitrogenylamine or phosphoinitrogenylcholine. So it's which means the P and PC. So in the white type cells, so infrared gamma plus arginine acid can specifically increase in just carbon 18 associated fatty acid phospholipids, but otherwise other than the other phospholipid. So because we know even for the same such as the combined 18 combined one copper band for solid lipid. The with the same molecular, they have different isomer. So as here as you can see, so even for example, for this we what you go analyze this common 18 with one double band. So those different monomer unsaturated fatty acid, both of them have the same molecular weight, but they have different structure of conformation. So we are wondering whether they still have specificity on those fatty acid can induce the tumor cell ferroptosis. So in this experiment, so we combine the infrared gamma A as the base level. So we use a low amount of arachnoid, then combine a different type of carbon 18 with one double band. So only one of them, the oleic acid, other than the other, more unsaturated fatty acid. So only oleic acid combined with different gamma A can dramatically induce the tumor cell death, also which can dramatically induce the tumor cell lipid growth. So which is mean the fatty acid compensation, fatty acid associated lipid compensation is dramatically changed by infrared gamma and arachidonic treatment. So then next we get into the, we want to demonstrate whether this ACF4 knockout tumor cell also have the immune phenotype, because the combination of arachidonic with infrared gamma is very strong, have very strong phenotype in the in vitro. So then we move into the in vivo. So quite interesting. So when we inoculate the YAM family ACF4 wild type cells or knockout cells in the NSC mice, which is mean immune deficient mice. So the tumor growth is not different between wild type and knockout cells. But CA75, which is the immune competent mice, so you will find out the ACF4 tumor is much bigger than the wild type cells. And so then we examine this tumor by the lipid growth, and indeed the knockout tumor sample have less lipid growth and have a shorter lifespan. And then we take off the tumor sample and examine the immune cells, and in the ACF4 knockout tumor samples, we find out they have less the CD8 and the CD4 T cells, and also have the less the cytokines such as infrared gamma in the CD8 T cells, or TMAF in the CD8 T cells. So which means we find out that this ACF4 tumor cell, knockout tumor sample is really have this, based on the ferroptosis death, the higher potential the tumor antigen release and the span. So we know the infrared gamma signaling play a very critical role in this immune chicken blocking induced immunity. So we are wondering whether when we giving the arachidonic plus infrared gamma and in the in vitro can induce the ferroptosis, we hypothesis whether we give the about arachidonic as a supplemental to the tumor-based mice to give the better anti-immune efficacy. So in this, also we inoculated YAM family 2 tumor model, tumor in the mice. So the anti-PD-L1 and plus A have better anti-tumor efficacy compared with the single treatment. And then we also examined the different cytokine in the tumor samples, which in the combination treatment, the infrared gamma and the TNF-alpha is much higher than the control group or single treatment. So we are wondering whether this is dependent on ACSL4 or STAT1 pathway or not. Then we inoculate the wild type cells or ACSL4 knockout cells or STAT1 knockout cells. So when we supplement A into the mice by the IV treatment, we can see the tumor is much be reduced. But in the ACSL4 knockout tumor cells or STAT1 knockouts, the A and the efficacy is totally be impaired. So That means the A treatment, the AH supplemental treatment to prevent the tumor growth, tumor growth is really depends on ACSL4 or STAT1 in the tumor cells. So, so basically, it's our results demonstrate that unlike the ECI alone, so infrared gamma and A, so they cannot induce or they cannot trigger the tumor cell ferroptosis. But when we present together, so is a combination treatment in the in vitro or in the in vivo, we find out that this combination can really induce the tumor cell fibrotosis. This natural tumor fibrotosis mechanism, the conceptual similar to just fundamental finding such as the combination of different cytokines such as the TGF beta command IL-6, which is induced the TH17 or TH21 cells, or is there like the combination of TFR-alpha and even gamma together induced the PAM peritosis. So here, so our result, I think our result will stimulate the bridge of the interest in exploring the whether this mechanism is operated not only in the tumor immunity, but also in the autoimmunity on the infection immunity. So in addition, I think as the infrared gamma is often to produce by the active, the infective T cells. So the, I think I think our data will suggest that this natural tumor fibrotic deficiency maybe can be previously is unrecognized the feature of the maybe the cold tumor. So and then maybe give a new molecular target for the clinical trial in the future. So finally, I would like thanks the VP and the INCAS support. Also, thanks all of the members in this group. And typically, we would like thanks the chemical because all of the phospholipid analysis by chemical. And without their support, I think this project cannot move very smoothly. And I would like to take the quick screen.
Thank you very much, Dr. Peng, for this great talk. So yes, if anyone in the audience has any question, please raise your hand or type it in the chat and I will read it for you or give you the word. So I would like to ask a question. It's really, so you show that this mechanism of inducing ferroptosis is induced cancer cell killing, but I was wondering if this mechanism is only focused on cancer cells or might the arachidonic acid with the interferon gamma induce killing of another cell populations, including immune cells or other tissues surrounding the tumor microenvironment. So yeah, it's not really specific for the tumor, but yes, it might kill.
Very interesting question. So indeed, we also examined the effect on the T cells. So basically, so what we use the amount of arachidonic acid is quite low, so around 20 micromole. So when we choose some amount arachidonic acid in the T cells, so basically the T cell function didn't impaired. So but once we increase the arachidonic acid, indeed the high amount of arachidonic acid will in fact either reduce the cytokine production or the T cell the survival. So that is because that's why in the paper we mentioned we use a relatively lower dose of the arachidonic acid, which is didn't impair the other typical T cell function.
Okay. Yes, I don't know if there's more questions in the chat. So yeah, I mean, I would like to ask what would be the next step in this area of research? What would be next step with the data you have now? What would be the next research on that.
Yeah, so it's some, because we test several tumor models. So as we know, PD-1 therapy, so it's not always have effective effect on different type of tumor cells for just ACSL4 model. So we find similar things. So we find that some tumor is more sensitive to response interferon gamma and A induced tumor cell death, but some of them didn't. So we found out the ACSL4, the expression, or is the ACSL4 regulation by interferon gamma is not present in some type of the immune cell, in some type of tumor cells. So we are wondering why that have the other mechanism, which is regular ACSL4 expression, and to respond to the interferon gamma or other cytokine treatment, which is can trigger the ferroptosis. Maybe the next steps.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your presentation. Thank you, Miriam. And thanks everyone for joining to today's seminar. Next week, we're gonna have another seminar regarding a new type of cell division directly from Taiwan. And in 2 weeks, we're gonna have a CAR T cell immunology seminar. So you're welcome to join us, follow our social network. And thank you very much, Miriam. Thank you, Dr. Peng. It's been a really great talk. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.